can trust in who you are. You are my truth, you are my life. And everything you do is so intentional. Everything you allow is so intentional. It's not a detail, not a detail passes you by. Just leave.
I'm not gonna fight your truth.
process. I'm not gonna fight your truth, not gonna fight the process. I'm not gonna fight your truth, not gonna fight the process. I'm not gonna fight your truth, not gonna fight the process. I'm not gonna fight your truth, not gonna fight the process. I'm not gonna fight your truth, not gonna fight the process. I'm not gonna fight the truth, not gonna fight the process. I'm not gonna fight your truth, not gonna fight the process. Yes, Lord, you know best, you know best. I'm not gonna fight, not gonna fight your truth, not gonna fight anymore, anymore, anymore. Not gonna fight the process. Taking me on, taking me along on a journey, on a journey. And at times it's difficult, at times it's painful, at times it feels like you've left my side. I shout, where are you, God? 'Cause when I shout, where have you been, my God? When I shout, where are you, God? When I shout, where have you been, my God, why have you forsaken? Gently come and take my accusations. You gently come and speak your truth. Son, I've been here all along. Son, I've been here all along. Son, I've been fighting for you, fighting for you, fighting for you. Where you haven't seen, where you haven't known, sown in tears. Where you haven't seen, you haven't known, I've sown in tears for you. Where you haven't seen, you haven't known, I've sown in tears. Where you haven't seen, you haven't known, I've sown. Wasn't a day that I left you alone. There wasn't a day I've forsaken you. There wasn't a day I left you all alone. There wasn't a day that I forgot and forsaken. For you, my child. Oh, I've sown in tears for you, my child. Oh, I've sown in tears for you. You're not the only one that's cried. You're not the only one that's felt pain. I've sown in blood for you, I've sown in tears, I've sown in blood that you may have life, I've sown in tears, I've sown in blood for you, I've sown in tears, I've sown in blood for you, it says, I've sown in tears, I've sown in blood for you, I've sown in tears, I've sown in blood for you, to have abundant life, to know abundant life, to know your inheritance, to know what fullness means, what fullness means, to know what fullness means, to know what fullness means, to know what fullness means, I've sown in tears, I've sown in blood. Spirit of wisdom, open my eyes again. Spirit of revelation, open my heart again. Spirit of wisdom, open my eyes again. Spirit of revelation, open my heart again. Thank you. but your voice sounds like waters. Jesus, you're beautiful. I know that your eyes are like flames of fire. I know that your head is white as wool. I know that your voice sounds like waters. Jesus, you're beautiful. I know that your eyes are like flames of fire. I know that your head is white as wool. I know that your voice sounds like waters. Jesus, you're beautiful. Oh, Jesus, you're beautiful. Oh, Spirit of wisdom. Spirit of wisdom, open my eyes again. Spirit of revelation, open my eyes. Wisdom, open my eyes again. Spirit of revelation, open my heart as I want to see you. Oh, I want to see Jesus. I want to see.
Joy from morning, how you create beauty from ashes.
was torn, you mend again. You redesign the tattered thread by thread. You take the broken and destroy. You rebuild. You make whole. And joy begin to rise, and hope begin to light the dark, as our God exchanges old for new. Dawn has conquered night, and death is lost to life, and now we are exchanging old for. Yeah.
Lord, you are the God who makes all things new. Let us behold your glory tonight, Father. Can you just give us a hunger to see you, a violent desperation to just see your face in all its beauty, Father? You know, you say that one glance from us ravishes your heart. But God, we want you to do the same for us. We want one glance from you to just melt our hearts, Father. Let us just see you in your beauty tonight, Father. Just captivate us, God. Take us to that place of wonder and awe for you. In Jesus' name, amen. We will now be going into a time of worshiping in the Word. We encourage you to open your Bibles to tonight's passage, Psalm 16, verses 1 to 11. As we read through, we invite you to meditate on the Word, pray, and allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you through the passage. Once again, the passage is Psalm 16, verses 1 to 11. We will start with verses 1 to 5. Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. I say of the holy people who are in the land, they are the noble ones in whom is all my delight. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I will not pour out libations of blood to such gods or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. God, you are our refuge. You are our shelter. You are our rock. An ever-present help in times of trouble. And you say to us in Psalm 91 that if we say, the Lord is my refuge, and we make the Most High our dwelling, no harm will overtake us, no disaster will come near our tent, for he will command his angels concerning us to guard us in all our ways. So Father, whenever we face a crisis, whenever we face danger, let us, in the face of danger, look to you as our shelter. Look to you as our safety. Knowing that you protect us out of love. And Jesus, no one else will provide that. Nothing else in this world will provide that safety. Nothing else will provide that protection. Only you. And also, you are not only our shelter, you are also our Lord. Sometimes we don't understand the depth of your lordship. Sometimes we take for granted of your might, of your strength. And so, Father, just take us back to that place of awe and wonder of the Creator of the heavens and the earth. Help us to consecrate ourselves, to surrender everything to you. Just pray that this leads to just the repentance of any idols that we have set before you, God. Anything that we have made our Lord, just give it to you. We surrender it at your feet, because either you're the Lord of all or you're the Lord of nothing. You don't want this in between. You don't want this lukewarm spirit. You want us to be hot for you. You want us to be burning for you, God. Just as David said, apart from you, I have no good thing. Everything else in this world is considered trash. It's considered rubbish. The greatest we can gain from the world, the greatest money, the greatest power, the greatest influence, we could gain all the recognition, all the fame, but even still, it's considered no good thing compared to you. And we may run after these things all our lives, but you say they will suffer more and more. And you say that because you know it's good for us. And that's why Paul said to count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing you, Christ Jesus. So let us not lift our souls to another. Let us not even entertain them at all, not even pour out worship, not even utter their names on our lips. And as we cast down our idols, let the cry of our hearts be, just as it says in verse 5, how you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure, that even though everything may be provided to us, all the riches, all the power, all the influence, even though those are on the table, let us pick you first and foremost, without hesitation, God. We choose you first above everything. You are my portion. You alone are my portion. Not you and something else, only you, Jesus. You are more than enough. So we pray that we just come into your presence. We come to just a place of just security in you, our refuge. In a place of satisfaction where you are our portion, where you are our sole desire, where you are our everything, Jesus.
As I count all else as loss, have your lordship in my life. As I count all else as loss, have your lordship in my life. As I count all else as loss, have your lordship in my life. As I count all else as loss, have your lordship in my life. As I count all else as loss, have your lordship in my life. As I count all else as loss, have your lordship in my life. Have your way, God. Have your way, God. There is no other. There is no other. Have your way, God. Have your way. What I lay down.
Set our eyes on things eternal.
My inheritance is
portion and you are my cup. Psalm 16, verses 6 to 8. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Father, the boundary lines you have for us are not established in dark places and places of bondage or death, but in pleasant places. The same talked about in verse 11, the eternal pleasures at your right hand. The boundary lines are set in there, Father. And so we ask for your wisdom to stay in the boundaries, because going outside only does us harm. And so let us follow your commands. Let us follow your wisdom. Let us have Psalm 119 burned on our hearts, which is rich with verses and passages like, I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. Father, just give us a love for your commands. Let us not do it because it says so in the Bible. Let us not do it because you tell us so. Let us do it because it is our joy, it is our delight, and we desire to stay in those boundary lines of eternal pleasures, Father. And also we pray that we will rejoice in the inheritance we have, Jesus. That's you, and being with the Father. Being with the Father, that is more than enough of being a delightful inheritance. It is a great gift you have bestowed upon us, because Jesus, you made a way on that cross. You tore the veil so we can dwell with the Almighty Father. We just praise you for being our counselor. We trust in you as our counsel. And so let that develop a peace over our hearts. Despite what everything else in the world says, through media, through advertisements, through all the messaging that comes out of this world, give us the ears to hear your voice over everything that's being spoken out in this world. To hear your voice, to hear your wisdom. You are not only our refuge because of the protection you give to us, but you are our refuge because of your counsel. And so help us to follow your guidance, your teachings, your wisdom, to avoid the harmful things, to avoid the things that lead to death, and instead look to you, the source of life. And so Father, just let this also in turn allow us to keep our eyes always on you. As A.W. Tozer writes, it's lifting the mind to behold the Lamb of God and never ceasing that beholding for the rest of our lives. At first, this may be difficult, but it becomes easier as we look steadily at His wondrous person, quietly and without strain. Distractions may hinder, but once the heart is committed to Him, after each brief excursion away from Him, the attention will return again and rest upon Him like a wandering bird coming back to its window. And so, Father, we just pray that we behold You, Lamb of God, Jesus, we behold You, and we set our inward gaze of our soul constantly on You. Develop a hunger for Your presence with us, so much so that it becomes second nature. It becomes like a spiritual reflex that requires no conscious effort. And even though there are so many distractions in this world, help us to understand, God, the God who is waiting for us 24/7, who waits to talk to us, who waits to see us face to face, is more than willing to set aside all the distractions to just dwell with us. Your greatest desire is to dwell with us, Father, because You love us so much. You make a path through the mighty waters, Father. And we just pray that we just fix our eyes on You. And when we do this, knowing that You are at our right hand, supporting us, being our advocate, being at our right hand, giving us might and strength, let this allow us to not be shaken, even despite the circumstances of this world. Let us not be shaken. No matter what bad things may happen to us, let us not be shaken. Let us not look down at the waters. Just like when You called Peter on that boat, let us not look down at the waters or up at the wind. Let us look straight to You, Father. Even though the reality of our situations make it so real sometimes, so difficult sometimes, help us to look constantly to You, Father. Help us to look only to You, Father. Let our inward gaze be always to You.
unspeakable joy.
Things of this world not rob us of this joy.
This joy is my strength. Oh, this joy is my strength.
Psalm 16, verses 9 to 11. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful one see decay. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. God, like David, who said in verse 1, who said, keep me safe, my God, for you I take refuge. We're all afraid of death. But David went into a place of unshakable confidence because he knew you will not abandon us to the realm of the dead. Jesus, you took our place. You went through all of that. You conquered the grave. You are the one who overcame death. And that same being who overcame death is with us. The same person who says, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead and now look, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades. That same person is with us. And so let that give us an unshakable confidence, an unshakable fearlessness, even in the face of death. Just like David, let us be filled with just comfort. Our souls and our body rest secure because we have the joy of our salvation and nothing will take that away from us. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And you also say, if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. And so we pray, Father, that you will raise up an army of fearless believers filled with the life of the same Spirit who won't fear the worst of things in this world, like ruin, like persecution, like end-time shakings, like even death itself. A people who have this Spirit who will say like Job, though you slay me, yet I will still trust and hope in you, that they will still trust in you as their shelter and counselor and Lord. Father, give us just a courage, give us a boldness. No matter what threats may come our way, no matter what dangers may come our way, let us be filled with the joy of our salvation, that at the end of the day, we get to spend eternal life with you, Father. And as our counselor, Jesus, you make known to us the path of life. It's not the path of destruction. It is not the path of death. It is the path of life, Father. And we ask ourselves why we fail to see this path of life when there is joy, eternal pleasures at your right hand, right before us. We often settle for the mud puddle when there is a river of living water set before us. We often take eternity with you for granted. We take eternal life with you for granted. Why should we settle for anything else, Father? So God, give us the eyes to see that path you have set before us, that path you have paved before us, Father. Let us set our eyes above on things eternal. Give us just a glimpse, God. Give us a taste of what those eternal pleasures you are talking about are tonight, Father. Let us see those eternal pleasures, God, so much so that we want to come back for more of you, for more of those pleasures you have promised to us, that we would never want to run to anything else but you, Father. Jesus, fill us with life. Fill us with the pleasure that nothing else in this world can compare to every time we come to you, God. Fill us with a hunger for you. Death, where is your sting?
The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in you, lives in me. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in you, lives in me.
We are more than conquerors.
The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in you, lives in me.
Nothing will bring us down.
The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in you, lives in me. Joy.
pleasures that will not see decay.
At your right hand there are pleasures evermore. At your right hand there are pleasures evermore.
Pleasures that will not spoil or ruin.
At your right hand there are pleasures evermore. At your right hand there are pleasures evermore.
Pleasures that will satisfy us. Is over.
Satisfy my soul.
It's right before us.
You satisfy my soul.
We look to you.
You satisfy my soul. And you are dwell. And you are.
Father, through this passage you have taught us that there is nothing like you. You are our refuge, you are our Lord, you are our treasure, you are our portion, you are our cup, you are our counselor. There's nothing like you. We can search for everything in this world all our lives, but nothing will come close to you, God, and the things that you provide for us. So, like we prayed tonight, let us just constantly look to you. There may be so many distractions, but let us constantly look to you still. Just pray that we just seek after you. Let us just have a greater hunger coming from tonight, God. A greater hunger for you, a greater desire to see you. Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we will now come into a time of intercession for the nation of Korea. And as I pray, we ask that you come into agreement and then follow with your own intercession. Father, we just break off any fear of the future, any fear of failure, any just the poverty spirit over any family, God, in Korea, in this nation. We pray that you will lift off all pressures, all burdens on children and the family members, the pressure to succeed, the burden of just failure, let that be lifted off of them. That the college that they go to or the job they get, it doesn't matter. Let them trust in you. That their worth, their value is not in a job title. It's not in their college. It's in you, Father. worth is found in you. And let any temptation for comparison, any temptation for perfectionism, despite that temptation, let them look to you. Let them not be binded by the standards of society. Let them look to your standards, the standards that brings rest, the standards that brings peace, Father. And God, there are so many broken families in this nation for various reasons. And there are just so many uncomfortable tensions or conflicts that separate these families. But God, we pray your comfort and we pray for your love to wash over any bitterness or any hurt or any conflict that are present in these families. Any bitterness and any conflict that has spanned for years upon years, we pray for your love to break through right now. We declare peace over situations like families struggling with abusive parents, families at risk of divorce, families struggling financially. No matter what the situation is, your love triumphs over all. Your love, your peace remains. Your love and peace remains victorious over any situation. And Jesus, you are the Prince of Peace. And we ask that in all times, in every way, you will unify families in Korea. We ask that you will thwart the enemy's scheme to divide families, Father. You desire to see families who are unified, families who come together in love. And we pray against the attacks of the enemy. And we pray that despite any tension, any bitterness, or any hurt, that God, you will provide opportunities for reconciliation, for forgiveness between family members, that there will be no fear in the family members for confrontation, to address any elephant in the room whenever they meet, that they will not be afraid to speak out, but that they will speak from a place of love and they will speak from a place with honor, Father. And God, let them have a desire to forgive, because God, we've been forgiven by you. And whatever the reason, maybe these family members have experienced hurt or offense because of any wrongdoing by their family members or what they said. But God, you see all. You are a God of justice. And let them know that, God, you see it all and you will conduct your affairs accordingly, God. And God, you also say in Psalm 103, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. And God, that means you have a feeling of deep sympathy and sorrow for us whenever we're stricken by misfortune. And that comes with a strong desire in you to alleviate the suffering. So God, no matter what they've been through, God, let them know that you are with them, that you are compassionate, that you understand their situation. You know what they're going through, and that you are with them, and you are going to work your peace and love in their situation, Father. Give them the grace to forgive if it's any struggles with unforgiveness. Let them just, you desire to have them let go of this unforgiveness and be free from the cycle of bitterness. And we prophesy, God, relationships between families will become more radically transformed out of this conflict, out of this tension, and become more intimate out of these situations, God. Let's pray. God, in the midst of a society, of a nation that rewards hard work at the expense of personal health, at the expense of a lifestyle, where people come out of it exhausted, people come out of it just restless. God, we pray your peace to break down these strongholds. Whether it's from the bottom, or from the employees to the top, or the top down, we pray for peace to flow from all directions. A peace that goes against the societal norm. A peace that goes against this culture of just everything fast paced and where hard work is rewarded, God. We pray that the idol of recognition or the idol of acknowledgement from peers will just be broken in the name of Jesus, that people will work from the Colossians 3 heart, that they will work at everything with all their heart as working for the Lord and not for human masters, since they know that they will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ they are serving. So let them be working for you, not for man. And we declare that workers, they will work from a place of rest that produces excellent work. And let ultimately a culture of rest be established where rest is rewarded instead of hard work that just burns people out, God. And we pray peace and wisdom over business leaders and owners of this nation. We pray that springs of life and peace will flow from them from the top down, that any tension amongst people working under them will be resolved, and employees will work for them not out of bitterness, not out of selfish ambition or the desire to be on top, but they will work with honor for their superiors, God. And we just pray this idol of success or this fear of failure in these business leaders to be broken, that they can fully trust in you, that they don't have to worry about failure, God. And we just pray that you will lead them to establish a work culture free of any anxiety, fear or any pressure to succeed. That they will be a great counsel to their employees. They will be a great influence, a godly influence, a righteous influence to their employees, God. And even in certain crises, that these leaders will not be shaken, that they will conduct their affairs, they will make key decisions out of peace, not out of fear, not out of urgency, God. And we also pray peace over students who are also workers as well. We pray that, just as we prayed previously, that they will again be free from the burdens of their future and unrealistic expectations from their family, God. So many students study and spend so many hours. They pour out so many hours studying and just at school, but many students do it from a place of exhaustion. Many students do it from a place of just fatigue, but we just pray that they will do it from a place of rest. And let these students transform the people around them. That you are raising up a generation, God, of students who will work from a place of peace, who are not afraid or of the fear of failure, who are not afraid of where they're going to be placed, that they know that wherever they go, they will succeed. Wherever they go, they will have favor, God. That the college that they go to does not determine how their life is going to go. The job that they are going to get is not going to determine their value or their worth, God, in you. That at the end of the day, they are still fearfully and wonderfully made. At the end of the day, you promise them plans for prosperity, not for failure, God. At the end of the day, God, you are with them. No matter the college they go to, no matter their future, you are with them. Since the day they were born, you are with them, God. Let them be filled with that confidence, and let them just come to school, come to the schools with peace and rest in that fact, God. Let's pray. We declare your peace over the tensions between North and South Korea. We pray against any escalation of conflict that may be happening right now. Let it not escalate to conflict. Let there be an escalation to peace, God. And we pray that you'll provide opportunities for North and South Korea to set aside differences, to set aside any misunderstandings, that they will instead come together and they will come to understand one another. And we just pray against this eye for eye mentality. We pray that these nations will repay evil with blessing, God. And we pray, God, that Korea will not only be a model nation of peace before other nations, but act as a peacemaker who helps resolve conflicts between other countries. That they will be an example to other nations. That through the peacemaking that they show here, God, between North and South Korea, that other nations will look to them. Will look to this, look to Korea as a source of counsel, as a source of advice, God, to resolve any conflicts that they may be experiencing. And God, we prophesy your peace will ultimately bring reunification between these two nations. That these nations will not clash together in war, but we pray that they instead come together in peace and eventually become one nation. We pray against any dislike or hatred in this nation for North Korea just because they are North Korean, just because they are different. We pray against the mentality that reunification will do more harm than good. We pray against this cost-benefit mindset. We pray that they will just, this nation will look past the economic or political consequences and see the blessing of being able to converse, being able to fellowship, being able to worship you, God, as one nation. God, your desire is to see this nation unified in harmony. And And we pray that this nation contends for that. This nation desires for that, God. And we pray that this reunification be a testimony to other nations of your redeeming power, God. The same redeeming power that creates beauty out of ashes, that creates joy out of mourning, the power to redeem any situation. And this testimony to other nations, let it just produce peace, that these nations will receive this testimony and find peace as well, God. Let's pray. Father, you desire to see peace in this nation. You don't desire seeing conflicts or misunderstandings. You desire to see harmony and peace, God. And we just declare you, Jesus, Prince of Peace, to teach this nation what it means to be under your peace, under your rest. That wherever people of this nation go, whether it's to their workplaces or their families, wherever they go, that your peace will follow them. Just pray that you are radically transforming this nation to a place of peace, where ultimately this peace will lead to reunification with North Korea, God. Just declare peace over this nation once again. In Jesus' name, amen.